there not a more positive way of demonstrating in favor of peace than sitting in bed?
What's more positive? You know,
very positive.
Makes some people very uptight, but we've got to do it. Back Productions is what takes care of our business, you know, that's books, films and records.
Well, now you see, John and Yoko is a team, you see, and we're doing it together.
But you were a filmmaker before. Are you still going to make films?
Yeah. We're making films together now. Yes.
Well, you're on one now.
Yes. Yes.
You're in it. I think they might think I'm going to hot up the revolution, you know, I want to cool it down.
That's why we're doing this, because it's very urgent, and every one of us are in it.
If we make people laugh, that's enough. Mm-hmm. Happiness is a good vibe for peace. But they could, saying grow your hair for peace, or cut it off, have some sign on you that's for peace, you know. All we're saying is if you think you can do better, do it. You top it. Stop asking us, do you think it's going to work, you know, do something yourself.
If I'm going to get on the front page, I might as well get on the front page with the word peace.
But you've made yourself ridiculous.
To some people, I don't care.
If it you're too good for
if
what
it saves
doing.
Lives.
You don't think you... Oh, my dear boy, you're living in a nether.
Well, you talk to
them. You don't think you've saved a single life.
Maybe we'll save some in the future.
Maybe next year
it didn't do a bit of use. No, it's still gone down, so it didn't do anything.
What do you know about a protest movement anyway?
I know a lot about it.
It consists of a lot more than sending your chauffeur in your car back to Buckingham Palace.
You're just a snob about it. The only way
you're
to make...
You're a fake. Can't you give up something else that would mean a little bit more?
It doesn't, it's not the sacrifice. You can't get that into your head, can you? It was no sacrifice to get rid of the MBE because it was an embarrassment.
Then what kind of a protest did you make?
Advertising campaign for peace. Can you understand that?
No, I can't.
A very big advertising campaign for peace.
I think it's self-aggrandizing.
Well, you think
are
it's...
Are you advertising John Lennon or peace?
Do you want nice middle-class gestures for peace?
Maybe.
And intellectual manifestos written by a lot of half-witted intellectuals, and nobody reads them. Oh. That's the trouble with the peace movement.
I mean, I can't think of anyone who seems more remote from the ugliness of what's happening than you.
Well, I hope
I do see you getting up on a Tuesday morning and thinking, let's see, what should we do today and what war is going on?
Well, that's your imagination, you know, really. I mean,
you know, you carry on. Why don't you make a film while you're at it?
I'm someone who admired you very much.
Well, I'm sorry you liked the old mop tops, dear, and you thought it was I was very satirical and witty, and you liked Hard Day's Night, love, but I've grown up, but you obviously haven't.
Have you?
Yes, folks.
What have you grown up to?
No, 29.
Hi, I'm John Lennon, and this is Peace Weekend.
A CBC color presentation.
John Lennon is here in Canada selling peace. He is here in our studio tonight, along with Yoko. John, you've been terribly flattering to Canada since you've been around this week. What is it about Canada? Why is this peace movement being held here?
Canada is the first place that has given us something. For instance, the media and the press treat us as human beings.
Great.
I'm astonished.
I'd like to know why you wouldn't choose a place where war is going on right now, or where there is a dispute in progress. Vietnam, the Middle East.
A, because Canada chose us as much as we chose Canada. B, we had an offer to go to Biafra, and then we had to consider the pros and cons of risking going through an area like that, Biafra, Israel, or Hanoi, whatever it is. How much can we do alive or dead? I don't want to be Mr. and Mrs. Dead Saint of 1970.
Welcome to episode 76 of Glass Onion. I'm John Lennon, and this is John Lennon in 1969, part 2, with Scott Phipps. So, I haven't done one of these spoken intros for a while. I think the last one was just before Christmas, but it seems remarkably prescient, in fact, because I've just been putting together the clips for this show. There's lots of audio clips of John Lennon in 1969 talking about peace, and here I sit. It's lunchtime on the 25th of February in the UK. And of course, the story in the Ukraine is ever changing and evolving. I know this is not a political show, but I just wanted to say one quick thing before I get to today's show. Now, obviously, the victims in these situations are the Ukrainians and ordinary people, and it may happen that it affects the rest of the world economically as well. And it's interesting that my friend Luke Thompson posted on Twitter the clip of John Lennon saying that our leaders were insane. And I've also just been watching a remarkable documentary presentation made by Robbie Martin, which is called A Very Heavy Agenda, which is about the neoconservatives. You may have heard the names William Crystal, John Bolton, Richard Pearl, etc. They're not very well known, in fact. There might be a reason for that. Anyway, the reason I'm mentioning that is that with these events, things become a propaganda war. So if you're in Britain or America and you turn on BBC or CNN, there's only one story. You know, it's all laughably simplified. Putin is a tyrant. And, you know, it's sickening, really, to see Boris Johnson and Joe Biden and Justin Trudeau et al. Coming on and moralizing about Putin. And I'm not, for a second, I'm not a Putin sympathizer. I think they're all lunatics, as John Lennon said. And obviously there's an arms trade involved with this. And it's really too much to go into fully. You know, I should probably do a podcast on Life and Life Only about it. But, you know, if you turn on BBC and CNN, and then you turn on, for example, RT, Russia Today, you're just going to get two narratives which are simplified. The difference with RT, I think, is that you're actually going to be getting Western journalists, you know, such as John Pilger, talking about this and giving you the other side of it. But really, all I want to say is that just everybody, please be aware that there is heavy propaganda happening in the media about this. And please don't make any rash judgments and think that this is a simple situation. You know, it's been brewing for a long, long time. And I mention the neocons because, to be perfectly honest, this is their dream. Because you will see the US defense budget is going to go up and up. It's already astronomical. And the US is going to intervene at some point, in my opinion. And the other NATO countries are probably going to fall in line. And, of course, like I say, they'll all be moralizing at the same time. And I saw a report earlier today showing very, very graphic pictures of what's happening in the Ukraine. And, of course, it's a tragedy. Of course, it's a disaster. But where are these graphic pictures when it's Iraq or Syria or Libya, for example? So just please keep that in mind, you know, and it's worth researching this deeply because you're not going to get deep analysis on mainstream news. You're going to get 5-10 minutes, a couple of hand-picked experts, and, you know, it'll all seem very simple. And all the justifications for escalating this conflict and the NATO countries coming in will be, that'll be the only story you'll get, really. Very unlikely to get dissenting voices. But there's many, many podcasts out there, so worth having a listen to some of those, perhaps, and see if they offer something more realistic or more measured, more balanced. Anyway, that's all I'm going to say about that. I do want to get to today's show. So the clips you heard there, that was a little compilation, really. The first one was from the remarkable film Bed Peace from 1969, and there's a version of that online in very pristine quality, actually on the John Lennon official channel. So I'll put that in the show notes. Then you heard John's argument, discussion, whatever you want to call it, with Gloria Emerson, who was worked for the New York Times, the London office at that time. And I think she'd just been starting to cover the Troubles, as they're known, in Northern Ireland. And that was an example of the pushback that John and Yoko got for this apparently oversimplified message. You'll hear a clip of the famous occasion with Al Capp as well. Beatles fans will know that, I'm sure. There'll be a bit of that later. And then the last clip there was John in Canada in December. And I thought he talked a lot of sense. Yes, you can mock it. And they, of course, said we're willing to be the world's clowns. That last comment of John's you heard just before the music came in, I mean, obviously, horribly ironic. And he mentioned the possibility of losing his life, being shot. In fact, he mentioned that 2 or 3 times in interviews. Just wanted to quickly mention a couple of other things I've done recently. Again, some of you may have already seen this. The fantastic YouTube channel Pop Goes the 60s with Matt Williamson. He and I did a 3-parter on Get Back, and he put those online earlier this month. So they're there. I'll put those in the show notes. And also, this is a bit of a tenuous link, but I just did on Film Gold a review of Monty Python and the Holy Grail with the aforementioned Luke Thompson. And that's proved to be very popular and the reason I mention it is that obviously there is the Beatles Python connection through Neil Innes and the Ruttles and various other things, and Paul McCartney producing I'm the Urban Spaceman by the Bonzo Dog Doodah Band. And the Beatles actually got a few mentions during our conversation because we were talking about fascinating dynamics, and obviously Get Back gave us a little bit more of an idea of the John Paul George dynamic. Ringo was pretty much as we remember him, you know, the rock of the group and dependable. But the Pythons as well had a fascinating chemistry, and being six of them, I'm sure there was a great deal of creative tension, and Luke and I went into that during our talk. There's various other things that I've read and watched, but I think we need to get to the show fairly quickly. Just say I also reread The Beatles and the Avant-Garde, the fantastic book, and there's a little tribute to that actually at the end of this show. I always feel when I read about the Avant-Garde or watch a documentary about it or anything, it always makes me think that anything is possible with art, and that's really something that John and Yoko, among others, preached. And in fact, even during this year of 1969, he was preaching openness. There's a clip about that later. And really, you know, he highlights all the rules we impose on ourselves and the limits and the barriers we all impose. And a lot of the times there's really no need, you know, particularly with creative expression. With a podcast, for example, you know, you really can do anything. And you don't have to, of course, you know, if you prefer to see a podcast as like a radio show, that's absolutely fine. But with all things in life, creative expression and all the ways you express yourself, you know, the possibilities really are endless. I think that was part of John Lennon's overall message. While you're listening to our talk and the many clips that you're going to hear, maybe have a think about how John Lennon's message is relevant or not in 2022. And, you know, there's so much food for thought. You know, they put themselves out there, John Yoko, this year, and it was an electrifying year for John. He's obviously our focus, but Yoko was there most of the way or all of the way with him, and just endlessly fascinating. And Scott and I, we go through the events of the year and then we talk about the relevance of John Lennon in the modern day and why I keep Glass Onion going. And one final thing I should mention is that Scott and I actually did this talk in October. I'm clearing my latest backlog before I probably start another one going. This was, of course, before Get Back, and the original intention was to put this out, the laughably optimistic intention, to put it out before the end of November. I think in this part we mentioned that it's probably going to come out December, but here we are, you know, end of February, but there you go. We do speculate about what we expect to find with Get Back. And I could have cut it out, but then we would have been talking about 1969, not mentioning January at all. So I just left it in anyway, just in case you were, you know, you want to hear what we thought might happen in that film. Of course, we all know what has happened, and it was glorious. It was everything we wanted, really, and probably more. Anyway, I just wanted to mention that. Finally, if you'd like to help out the show, you can do that in various ways. You could just tell other people about the show, share links with them. You can also leave a rating, preferably a 5-star one, and a review on various apps such as iTunes and Stitcher. And any monetary contributions are, of course, welcomed. That's on buymeacoffee.com/AntonyRotunno. I haven't had time, to be honest, to put much bonus content on there, but I did post a piece about Revolution 9, which was an adaptation of episode 25 and will be in the book, which will hopefully be out this year. So any contribution you can make in any of those forms is greatly appreciated. I really think you're going to enjoy this episode, so I'm going to stop talking and let you get on with listening, and I'll be back on the other side with a few words. Enjoy. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Glass Onion on John Lennon. And we think this is part two of John Lennon in 1969. So Scott's back again. How are you doing, mate?
Hello, mate. Yes, this is deja vu, almost.
Yeah, this is actually a separate recording for real. We haven't just stopped the previous one for 1 minute and said, hi, everyone, welcome back. This is a genuinely different recording.
We needed a break, mate. We covered a lot of content in that first episode, didn't we? So,
yeah, it was a bit ridiculous how much was going on in 1969.
Yeah.
It's their fault, not ours. All right, here's a radical idea. Let's get to John Lennon.
3 hours down the line, mate. We finally get to what we're talking about.
That's far too much foreplay. Anyway, I was borrowing a stinking pause expression there. So I've heard you say that on a couple of your
episodes. Oh, we had a feature called Foreplay on Stinking Pause podcast many years ago, yeah.
Right, fair enough. All right.
I suppose that just one general comment about John Lennon in 1969. I think what's amazing is that even though Get Back is being slightly revised, and perhaps we're finding John Lennon wasn't quite as lethargic, let's call it.
Yeah.
It is amazing this year that he starts the year appearing to be in a kind of a heroin haze. I would just say a bit lethargic, hasn't got lots of songs going. But then the speed of activity of him and Yoko, I don't know, from about March for the rest of the year, is just breathtaking.
It's headline making everywhere they go, isn't it? It's just the summer of John and Yoko, pretty much.
Yeah, the bed-ins are a big part of that. The other thing about him is that, you know, whether you think he looks cool, I think he looked amazing at that time, but whether you think he looks silly, he's visually striking.
Yeah, the white suit, the long hair, the beard.
Yeah,
not afraid to wear the glasses. You know, he's been doing that now for a couple of years.
Dressing in white for a lot of the year as well.
Yeah, yeah.
And Yoko, you know, that, I mean, they're taking that idea that, that often couples, after they've been together, they start to look visually similar.
Well, they've got the same
haircut.
They've
obviously done that very...
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. But they do, yeah, they do look, I think, visually very striking. And we'll get later to the Toronto concert. But I remember watching that when I was about 14 and being a bit afraid of him, actually.
Afraid?
Because
right.
He looks... Well, there was an edge to him. And I think, thinking of that Toronto concert, I think he was definitely on something as well. Because there's a certain... I don't know, he's got that slightly druggy look in his eye as well.
Yeah.
But I remember looking at him thinking, Jesus, look at the size of this beard, because that was the height of it. It was about August.
I had that on VHS when it came out, and I don't think I've seen it since. I'll have to find a copy again and have another little look at that. But I remember watching that early to mid-80s, I think, was the last time I've seen that.
It's very heady. It's very 1969.
Yeah.
It's a heavy atmosphere, but it's very, very interesting. All right, so Get Back... This episode, the way it's looking, may not even come out by the time we get back. But why don't you just tell me what you are expecting, or perhaps you're not expecting anything, for the Peter Jackson film?
A completely different take on what we know, or thought we knew, because I think it's sort of well documented now that those recording sessions weren't as dark and fractious as we've been led to believe. There's a lot of positive stuff came out of that recording session in early 69. Yes, there was a lot of tension. You know, Harrison walked out at one point, and the whole direction was never fully realised because there was supposed to be a TV special. You know, the live concert just ended up being the rooftop appearance. You know, they didn't know exactly where this was going to go because they were all tired. They'd been together day in, day out for years and years. I'm hoping to see a lighter side to what we thought we knew, something a bit more positive.
Yeah. I think literally it was quite dark. I don't know how dark that Twickenham set was, but maybe Lindsay Hogg lit it quite dark as well. I think this is all going to be literally brighter. It's just going to be brighter in every way, I think. But sorry to the listeners for saying this again, but I'm going to just revel in the footage and not really worry too much about what I'm being told about the narrative, because I listened to most of the Naga reels. I have some idea, and it's somewhere in the middle. You know, boringly, the truth is always somewhere in the middle, isn't it?
I think it's in the right hands of Peter Jackson. I don't know what people's opinions are of Peter Jackson being given this, but when you look at, you know, what he did with that old footage of the World War One stuff that he did, you know, colorized it and just cleaned it up, and it was a fantastic documentary. And I think they're making the right decision of making it 6 hours long and splitting it up like this, because this story can't be told in an hour and a half.
Yeah, I suppose if they'd gone back to the original thing, it would have been 2 hours in the cinema and then probably another 4 hours of extras.
Yeah.
I imagine.
I like this idea,
But then the misconception I had, I don't know if this was a popular one, was that he was going to be using those techniques from They Shall Not Grow Old.
That was it, yep.
And then I never heard anything about it, so presumably he isn't.
I'm sure they've remastered everything. They've cleaned everything up. I don't know what extra can he bring, you know.
No, but you're actually using that same technique of making it, I don't even know what you call it, semi-animated.
Oh,
semi-live action. This technique he was going to use.
Yeah, it'd be interesting to see then, because we've got the new trailer, didn't we, a couple of weeks back, and it just looks like a documentary. You know, it's similar to those that are familiar with the original movie. You know, we'll recognise it immediately. It'd be interesting. I'd just like to see what sort of spin he's going to put on it, because for a lot of people, especially non-Beatles fans, it's going to be quite dull. It will not appeal to everybody, apart from you, me, and a couple of million other people.
Yeah, the family.
Yeah.
I heard a review of it about 3 days ago, but I can't remember which show it was on. And they were saying it's shaping up to look a bit like Keeping Up with the Beatles,
right.
Like as in Kardashians, as in sort of weird reality show. Because if you think about it, it is a tiny bit Big Brother, because they're there all day.
Yes.
And you'll see them doing mundane things like, oh, do you want a cup of tea? Or, you know, Mal, get me a cup of tea. Yeah, that kind of thing. What was I listening to? God, I wish I could remember that. Maybe I dreamed it.
That's probably the bits that I'm looking forward to most of all then, I think. You know, it's the stuff we haven't seen. We know the stories. You know, there's 1,000 books out there that have written about the Let It Be sessions. But to see them cleaned up on a fairly big screen with the perfect music soundtrack, you know, the perfect soundtrack in 5.1 stereo, whatever they're going to do it in. I know you are really looking forward to it, probably more than anybody I know.
Yeah. Like I say, it's the footage, really. And one thing to look out for, if you ever see a really, really sharp photo or video of a recording studio, now, if you ever seen that famous photo of John Lennon lying on the floor recording Revolution?
Yes.
Look around. It's brilliant how many objects there are around the studio. Like, you'll see, like, a can of something.
Yeah, packet of cigarettes.
Prototype of Coke, Coca-Cola, but... Yeah, cigarettes. They used to get Chinese takeaways, apparently. So there'd be like food packets lying around.
Yeah.
It's very much has a sort of student-y look about it. But when you see this studio, you will suddenly notice all these objects lying around. Okay, so I don't really want to speculate anymore about that. But the other thing that happened in January 69, actually, Yellow Submarine was released.
Of course
just
it
slipped
was.
Out unnoticed. That's the soundtrack album rather than the film.
Yeah.
Film was the previous year. And then John Yoko, of course, met Alan Klein. And John did the kind of time-honored thing of putting everything into this person. You can take care of all my affairs.
Yeah, and was this the same sort of time that Paul was looking at his father-in-law? Was it his father-in-law he was trying to bring in?
Yeah, father-in-law and brother-in-law. They were kind of a team, yeah. Lee and John Eastman.
That was it. They were talking about, you know, trying to get them to manage the band, you know. And then Phil Spector was... on the back burner somewhere as well at one point, wasn't he?
Well, it took a long time, actually. It was quite near the end of the year that he actually was brought on board.
Yeah.
I don't know what he was doing for the rest of that year. Here's another amazing Beatles coincidence. The Eastmans, do you know what their original family name was?
Kodak, isn't it?
No, but that's not them. No, it's a different Eastman.
Oh, is it? Their original surname, Eastman? Eastwood?
Yeah, Jewish. No, Epstein.
No.
Yeah, really. Honestly, no joking. Yeah, that's one of those things that you just think, how could that possibly be? Because John Lennon apparently found out, or Klein found out and then told John before one of these Apple meetings.
Oh, wow, okay.
And as recorded by Goldman, but also a couple of other people, John was just going on about Epstein the whole meeting. Oh, if I had a name like Epstein. But what a bizarre coincidence.
That is incredible. Yeah, I didn't realise that at all.
A couple of other things that happened early in the year. He returns his MBE. I think you mentioned Nigeria and Biafra last week.
Yes, that was this year, yeah.
And then at some point he changed his name to John Ono Lennon.
Yes, because it was Winston, yes.
I think officially the rest of his life he was John Winston Ono Lennon.
Oh, right, okay, so he kept it all.
Yeah, and then they started Bag Productions. Now, the idea of the bags, of course, is a fantastic one, is that if you went to a job interview in a bag, they wouldn't be able to have any prejudice. Well, they'd probably have prejudice against you for turning up in a bag, but no, I mean, like, in terms of your voice or...
It's described as a satire of prejudice, I think I read somewhere. The whole bagism concept. People are not judged by their body shape or their body appearance, isn't it? It was the whole thing about... Well, not even body, it was sort of like even like ethnicity and gender and all of that, you know, it covered everything.
Yeah, I mentioned the voice. I suppose the voice wouldn't make a difference, but visually, yeah, if you... So I said, if you went to a job interview or something and they couldn't see what you looked like, they would be less prejudiced. I like the idea. And I think Bag Productions was kind of like the film equivalent of Zappel. It was a label that was set up, or a film company that was set up to make these wacky films. Anything goes.
Like. Yeah.
There's a very striking appearance of John and Yoko on David Frost, which you can see on YouTube, I think.
Yep.
And again, just so visually striking. But he also doesn't take himself at all seriously. He's having it up the whole time. It's very, very interesting.
Welcome, please, John Lennon and Yoko Ono.
Thank you. this is Acorn for Peace Week now, so here goes. You ready?
Mind the camera there.
Oh, no. Okay, go. If you plant them, you get trees. Not fast enough.
Let me help you.
Can no I damage, no damage.
Am I allowed to? Oh, you.
Excuse us, won't you? Yes, do have some, David.
Now tell me, what's the significance? Have one of those.
Well, acorn is a seed, and seed of life and hope, and maybe if some people planted them, they'd hope we lived that long.
And only God can make a tree, didn't someone say?
Yeah, that's right, isn't it?
Something like that. Very
front
good.
Row, come on, cheer up now. I know you've been here all day. Happy birthday, Queen, as well.
And if viewers at home would like to write in for their one free acorn. Yes. When I last saw you, one of the things you were doing was very keenly this thing of knocking nails into pieces of wood, right?
Which I didn't do it. That was a piece of Yoko's, a piece of art that was brought along. Hello! To show you. Yeah. And to explain concept art, I suppose. Mm. But we were knocking, David, you're correct.
I brought you. Oh, we brought
here's
you
another piece.
Another piece. A present.
To David, a box of smile.
We give him a lot of gear, he throws it away after. You'll regret it. Still looking for his Picassos. See, get it?
It's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen.
We thought you'd like it.
Oh, I adore it. Thank you very much indeed. I shall carry it with me at all times.
I like your equipment.
Yes, we've got a little record player here because we wanted to play a bit of your record.
Now, getting a bit low, are you?
No, because you did the record where you were both photographed on the cover fairly...
Naturally.
And you did that for what reason?
Well, the story is, before Yoko and I became involved, I was going to produce her as an artist, you know, she wanted to make records. And her work was all this pure and simple and white. So I thought, I was in India, remember that? And I was thinking a lot, you know, and I was thinking, what would be the best LP cover for her to get over the concept of her work? So I thought, naked. And I wrote this little letter to her and I gave her a drawing, which she, hello. So then when I got home and we got involved, I thought the most natural thing was for us both to do it, because we both made the record together. So we did it, you know, and had it just been her, there wouldn't have been anything. You know. Oh, you can have nude women, that's all right, but not men, who? You know, so I didn't know what I was doing till it happened.
And it's very interesting where various record companies chose to place the price tag.
Yeah, it was in a brown paper bag in some part of the States, you know. It's going for £10 on the black market, so...
Is it really? This is rather respectable, though once...
Well, see, it was a reflection of where we were then, Two Virgins. The music was us meeting...
But why did you call it Two Virgins?
Because
you weren't Two Virgins.
Yes, but I mean, it's you take every bit of poetry, literally. We were Two Virgins conceptually. We met on... our minds met on the music of the record, and our bodies met on the cover of the record, and it was just a concept. So this... That was how we were then. We considered our meeting as us Two Virgins meeting, right? And this is what was happening then, you know, and we were in hospital having my miscarriage and we've been arrested on the other side. Yeah. I mean, like Beatle records are the same. They reflect what we're doing now and you reflect what you're doing now. And we're doing it literally.
But you do share with us a great deal of your lives, don't you? I mean,
Everybody's hiding with these walls around them. What have we got to hide, you know?
Well, nothing after that.
So, right. But I mean, what about it, you know? What are we hiding from each other? Everybody's so frightened that they'll see... I must do this in case he sees how weak I am or how strong I am or whatever. Everybody's just got these walls around them.
That's true.
We've broken down a few barriers between us, you know, which we had to do because we had two big egos, two individual artists, and in spite of and with love, we overcame that. So what we're doing is sort of trying to share what we've experienced with everybody else that we can communicate with and say, you know, it worked for us and it was hard. And we're open, you know, we're not hiding anything as best we can. And it doesn't hurt, and it's very comfortable. So why are you so frightened?
They managed to get Eamon Andrews in a bag, didn't they? And I think even Parkinson a couple of years later.
I think I remember the Parkinson one. I didn't know about the Eamon Andrews one.
Yeah, that was in 69, I think. Parky was 71, just before they left England,
yeah.
I think. And then in March we have this strange thing of John and Paul both getting married. What do you think that was all about? Was that conscious?
Well, Lennon had been married previously. We know that. Paul McCartney had recently split up from Jane Asher. they'd been together quite a while, hadn't they, before he met Linda?
Yeah, he was caught in flagrante sometime in Easter or something, 68, and then took up with Linda fairly soon after that.
Yeah. It's not a case of one trying to outdo the other, surely.
I don't feel it was competitive. Yeah, you could always say it was, and it's probably something bubbling under there. But Paul obviously went first. Obviously, John's wedding was organised very quickly, as detailed on the song. They tried one place, they tried another, and then they ended up in Gibraltar.
Gibraltar, yeah.
But it's this weird similarity. They're supposed to be these opposites, but they both get married to older American ladies.
True.
Who both had daughters born in 1963 from a previous marriage. John Lennon, of course, had a son. Well, one thing I did want to tell you, do you know the story of Paul McCartney's wedding day and George Harrison and everything?
No, please tell me. Go on.
I'm hoping you don't know this because this is so amazing. It's just, it's so 1969. Paul got married, and you probably know that George got busted on the same day.
Yes.
So that was, well, almost certainly a conscious choice of Pilcher and the others. So George wasn't home. Patty was home. And the police either burst in or knock on the door. And obviously she rings George, and George comes back. When George comes back to his house, the police are in the living room listening to Beatles records. Yeah, getting the old vinyl out. Which is weird enough. And then in the evening, they go to, I think it was called like a Pisces party. I don't know if it's exclusively for Pisces, but they went to a party, and Princess Margaret,
yes,
otherwise known as Priceless Margarine, from the John Lennon books, is there with Lord Snowden.
Right.
And one of the other Boyd sisters, one of the inexhaustible supply of gorgeous Boyd sisters, fires up a joint, and someone passes it to Princess Margaret. But it's just another day in 1969, isn't it?
Of course, yeah. It's just all happening this year. We've agreed on this, haven't we? The bit that amazed me, we were talking about Alan Klein earlier. Prior to Alan Klein being approached, did you know John Lennon spoke to Lord Beeching?
Yes, I didn't know that.
Chairman of British Rail, to take over management of the Beatles, which I think is absolutely incredible. For somebody that was so anti-establishment, asking like a peer of the realm to manage their financial affairs. Absolutely amazing.
That is incredible about face, isn't it? Yeah. A lord in a suit. Because he's been railing against fucking suits and things like that.
But he actually approached him. I believe it was like late 69, late 68, early 69. Yeah.
And I hope that thing about him being offered the role of Jesus that I mentioned last time.
It would have worked.
I hope that's true.
It would have worked, mate. Absolutely. Would have been perfect.
Yeah. Okay, then we get the first bed in, which is essentially their honeymoon.
Yes.
Is this the one with Al Cap, or is that the second one?
Oh. I don't know. Was that in Amsterdam? I can't remember when that was.
Amsterdam was the first one, right? Yeah, in March. I think we talked about this, to be honest, last time you were on, or the first time you were on, when we did the Imagine film.
Mm.
And then he documents it fantastically in the Ballad of John and Yoko.
Yeah.
What do you think of that song? Is that top-tier Beatles, middling?
It's a bizarre one because I'd never really associate it as a Beatles song. I think a lot of people don't. People see that as like a John Lennon solo thing. It's catchy. It's one people know. It's one that, for me, I always forget was number one.
Mm.
I don't know why. It's probably because it doesn't appear on an album. It's one of those ones that was just a single, wasn't it, I think?
Yeah. Yeah, ended up on Past Masters.
Yeah. And for that reason, I always forget that it was a number one single. It's about right for that period of time. It certainly wouldn't have sat on Sgt. Pepper or any of those albums. It probably would have worked on Abbey Road. It's just an indication of what everybody was up to at this time, mate. You know, and that's why I always, in my mind, it always just reminds me of just a solo project by him.
Yeah, and it's very Chuck Berry, this whole idea, because there's a through line, really, between Chuck Berry and the Sometime in New York City album, because he's kind of doing the same thing there, but I think he pulls it off a little bit better. I quite like the Sometime in New York City album, I've got to say.
Yeah.
But it's that storytelling, that sort of strange meter and the narrative. And, of course, it has this distinction of being the only song in the history of rock music to have just John Lennon and Paul McCartney on it. So
exactly.
It's almost the Nerf Twins.
Yeah, almost a solo. And don't forget, I mean, he's also formed the Plastic Ono Band this year as well.
Yeah.
So you can understand why his heart really wasn't lying in the Get Back sessions when he's got all this really experimental stuff, you know, going on with Yoko.
He's got these very much parallel worlds.
Yeah.
He's still with the boys. doing rock.
But then he's just going off on a completely different tangent with the missus. Yeah.
Well, that's probably essentially his two sides, isn't it? The highly artistic side and then the rocker.
Yeah.
You know, some point or other, he buys Tittenhurst Park, which I think, again, that other time you were on, we decided was 71 acres.
Right.
Only 71 rather than 99.
Yeah.
Sounded like a great number. But
we could see most of it in that helicopter shot as well. It was just incredible, wasn't it, watching that, you know, the helicopter.
Yeah, I think I was asking you, is that all his back garden?
Yeah. We thought it might have been. Yeah.
But that's bizarre. Like, in this year where he said to Ray Coleman, oh, you know, we'll be broke in 6 months, he sort of made this public announcement about Apple, or public comment, let's say. How does he then get, I think it was 150 grand, which of course is quite an amazing price. If you could get it for anything like that now, obviously you wouldn't with inflation, but that would be an amazingly good price.
Didn't Ringo move into it afterwards?
Yeah, I think he owned it.
I think Ringo bought it off him, didn't he?
Yeah, in about 70, 72, maybe soon after they'd left.
Yeah.
That's right, yeah. Because John used Ringo's Montague Square flat, another one where quite a lot of stuff happened, where they made Two Virgins. And
that's right. Well, that would have been...
Where they shot the cover, sorry. That was late 68, I think, yeah. And then we get the second bed in and we get Give Peace a Chance.
Baggism, faggism, shaggism, draggism, haggism, flaggism, and the shag bag raggism. But all we are saying is give peace a chance. All we are saying is give peace a chance. Everybody's talking about Yoko Ono, Roka Bono, John Lennon, Derek Taylor, Michael White, Tommy Trinder, Dickie Potter, Dickie Peddow, Dickie Henderson. All we are saying is give peace a chance. All we are saying is give peace a chance.
Have I already told you about Petula Clark?
Did we mention it, or did we mention it off air?
Oh, just in case. Petula Clark was there, but I don't think she's on the... Yeah, I remember, yeah, because I said to the listeners, cover your ears. Cover your ears now, listeners. She's not on the original record because the people on it were not... We weren't professional musicians, so they had to actually do a lot of touching up later on of the record.
It's incredible. Again, there's a film that goes with it, obviously, isn't there? It's not pop video as such, but there's a record of the recording of it. Timothy Leary was there, wasn't he?
Yeah. Derek Taylor.
Well, Derek Taylor just used to float about everywhere, didn't he, with his little neckerchief, you know. You always spot Derek Taylor in the background somewhere. Let's have a look. It's the Queen Elizabeth Hotel in Montreal. There we go. Four microphones and a four-track tape recorder. That was it.
There's lots of Hare Krishnas there, I remember from the video. And just the whole thing of recording in his pyjamas.
Yeah. The producer, who was a guy called Andre Perry, this is sort of highlighting what you were saying. The intention was there was going to be no overdubs. Mm. But when he went back and listened to it, there was a lot of background noise. So they kept all the original stuff, and then they called a group of people into the studio. Just reading it here, he dubbed the original four-track to an eight-track machine, then used the other four tracks to overdub some voices.
Yeah.
Played it to John the next day. He thought it was wonderful. Keep it as it is. There's a story going around about overdubbing in London. Nothing was overdubbed in England. The only thing that was overdubbed was some of these people on this extra track. But there you go. Ooh. So isn't the original record... That'd be interesting. Is the original recording available anywhere?
I've heard one where it does sound like it's in the room, but then it comes out sounding quite similar to the final record.
So yeah.
Maybe they even just used an early mix of that and put it over this footage. But I just think it very much stands up because it's simple... But it's got that sort of busking appeal of it.
It definitely sounds like a busking anthem. And the big thing about this as well, it was credited to Lennon-McCartney. And Lennon regretted that many years later. He said, I was guilty enough to give McCartney credit as co-writer on my first independent single instead of giving it to Yoko, who'd actually written it with me.
Which is
interesting that he's done that, you know, because he was so devoted to Yoko. You'd have thought that would have been the first thing he would have considered.
Yeah. And I mean, for going back to the busking, for a guitarist, it's literally two chords, I think.
Oh, there you go. It's nice it's and simple.
It's got that appeal.
Nice and simple.
But just hearing it, as I said, I'm recording at some point in the future a review of US versus John Lennon. And hearing it now, again, it's one of those ones that just improves because the space in it, which is quite sparse, of course, the space in it kind of gets amplified in a strange way. So if you hear it on good speakers and stuff, it's just as powerful as it ever was. Probably more. That's where the technology helps, I think.
It's one of those great, almost sort of spontaneous moments that could never be recreated. You know, we could never get all those people in another room a month later, a year later, and recreate what he did there.
And I'm not sure you could get that voice either from anyone else. Someone could do a good version of it, I'm sure. But there's a certain eloquence. And again, I don't know if it's because I was exposed to it as a young man and it's just stayed with me, but there must be some thing that people pick up on, the eloquence of his voice. And
yeah.
All the little asides as well. There's a bit where he goes, "You can't ban this one," because they were banning all his records. Let's stick to it.
The third verse contains a reference to masturbation, according to Wikipedia. Yeah, right. But Lennon changed it to mastication on the official lyric sheet. He admitted this was a cop out, but he wanted to avoid unnecessary controversy.
Yeah, but now when you look at it now, that probably seems not that unusual.
No.
It's sort of an MTV unplugged in your hotel bedroom, but that must have been seriously radical for the time.
Yeah, and you know, to have it filmed as well, that's the thing. It's we've got the record of it as well, which is marvellous. Any Beatles visual record is marvellous, in my opinion, you know, just to see what was going on.
Yeah, absolutely. And then for people who don't know too much about this, yeah, the Al Cap, just direct listeners to the Al Cap, C-A-P-P, Encounter. What else? What are the other ones he had? Were all the other ones fairly friendly at the bed-ins?
Yeah, that was the one that really got his back up, and you can see it. We spoke about this at length in the Imagine one, didn't we?
He refers to Yoko as Madame Nu, which is the first lady of Vietnam for a while, who wasn't very popular.
So. Yeah. he went in there looking for a fight, basically.
Yeah.
And he picked the wrong man.
Yeah, he went out with his peace and love and got a bit scary again. It's that look in his eyes, that 1969 sort of scary look in his eyes. Sometimes.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, one of the things that interested me was the method you've chosen. This is to inspire peace, clearly. Yeah.
We're trying to sell it like soap, you know, and the only way to sell is to focus attention and sell every day.
Well, you feel that being in bed compels more attention than if you were sitting on chairs.
Yes, and it makes it easier for us because we talk 10 hours a day and it's functional for us to be lying down. What are you doing about it?
What am I doing about it? I'm cheering the police. That's precisely what I'm doing about it.
Why?
Now, you people have a home in London. Are you permitting people to come in and defecate on the rugs, smash the furniture, and beat you up?
Why
do you want them to do it at Berkeley?
We don't want them to do it at Berkeley. We're telling them to protest some other way. If they stayed in bed at Berkeley, they wouldn't have got killed.
Now, simmer down. Remember, we're all just rest.
Conversation instead of, you know,
I'd be delighted with any conversation.
Okay, I'd like to ask what you said about John Byers. You know, it's good to just.
I can see why you want peace. God knows you can't have much.
Do you think that people that are shy have to wrap themselves up?
Following with your description of yourselves as. If
would you
that
consider
is
yourself shy?
A picture of two shy people,
okay,
I'd like to know what shyness
shy?
Is.
May I ask you, would you consider yourself shy?
Oh, I'm just normal, but I think that everybody owes it to the world to prove they have pubic hair. And you've done it. Tell you that I applaud you for it.
I mean, if you want to prove it, you can prove it.
I don't feel that there's any great interest in it. Clearly, you must have felt the world wanted to know what your private parts look like, and now the world knows.
The lyrics go, Christ, you know it ain't easy, you know how hard it can be. The way things are going, they're going to crucify me and you, baby.
And then in the lyric, you said they were going to crucify you.
Yeah, if you take it literally.
Well, how did you mean it? I know that.
It means everything you want it to mean.
What did you want it to mean?
They're going to crucify me and you and everyone else.
If he's crucified, you...
Well, I haven't said that they were going to crucify me.
I have.
You make the claim they're going to crucify you.
Well, if you're going to take it literally...
Me is you.
Me, and
you.
I don't permit you to speak for me.
Who are you speaking for? I took that liberty,
Mr. Cap.
Well, it's too much of a liberty.
I'm speaking on behalf of the people in general, you know, in a poetic sense.
You're speaking for yourself.
I hope it doesn't upset you.
Now, you're not my spokesman. Are we agreed?
I'm everyone's spokesman.
No, you're not mine.
As a representative of the human race, I'm speaking for us all, whether you like it or not.
Whatever race you're the representative of, I ain't part of it.
Who do you write your cartoons for?
I write my cartoons for money, just as you sing your songs.
Exactly the same reason.
Yeah,
and exactly the same reason much of this is happening too, if the truth be told.
But if
do you think
Martian...
I could earn money by some other way, by sitting in bed for 7 days, taking shit from people like you? I could write a song in an hour.
Now, don't say this. You got into bed so people like me
can
see you.
Not for money. That's what you're saying. But I can earn money in easier ways than doing this.
I'll tell you what would do you harm. So could I. I could make a lot more drawing people like you than confronting you. And I must say it's much more appetizing drawing them because I can leave.
I prefer singing to doing this, but I'm doing this for
what you've just done is when you said taking shit from people like you. Now I was invited here. You knew I was coming.
Yeah, sure.
That's right.
But we're not doing it for money. You indicated I was doing it for... Oh, you have manners?
I'm your guest. And really...
And I'm yours.
No, you're not. This is your bedroom.
I'm delighted to have met you, Madam New. And J.C.
Great meeting you, Barabbas.
But I'm sure the other three guys are Englishmen.
What does that mean?
Think about it.
It's been a great deal for Pete, Mr. Gass.
And then the brilliant thing, you know, he goes to the lyrics of Ballad of John Yoko as Al Capp's walking away. He goes, Christ, you know it ain't easy. Yes. You know how hard it could be. The way things are going, they're going to crucify.
God.
July, we have the bulk of the Abbey Road sessions. And just before that, of course, we have this famous car crash in Scotland.
Yes.
John was taking Yoko to visit some of his relatives. I just read Julia Baird's book, actually, a big recommendation. It's called Imagine This.
Oh, because I've got the original one, John Lennon, My Brother.
Geoffrey Giuliano.
Mm.
He's not well regarded
by the Beatles community.
But
no, there's a Julia Baird one from a few years ago called John Lennon, My Brother.
She did it with him, yeah.
Oh, yeah, right, okay.
She kind of updated it, but it's very, very interesting. I'd rather not go into it now. Purely because we're on a roll here.
Okay.
But Aunt Mimi, you really get an interesting sense of Aunt Mimi. Very, very complex sort of psychology going on there.
Right.
Okay. Anyway, he went to Scotland because he always had good memories of Scotland because he's had these holidays there as a child.
Yeah.
They have this car crash. And when I had Ken McNabb on a couple of years ago, we kind of did 69. There's a rumor that maybe they were drying out from heroin in the hospital because the injuries they actually had, I think one of them had quite a few stitches. One was treated for a concussion.
Mm.
Perhaps they didn't need to have been in that hospital. So that was that's a rumor that's going around. And then we get this incredible thing of they get back to London. John comes to join the Abbey Road sessions and they get a four-poster bed set up for Yoko with a microphone by the bed in case she wants to make any comments. And if that wasn't surreal enough, Dan Richter, who once again is said to me, you know, anything I say to you on your podcast can be repeated. He was actually bringing heroin. He has a very distinct memory of going in the studio and going up to Yoko's four-poster bed and giving her a wrap of heroin or something. I mean, heady days, crazy days.
Because I'm just looking, you just going back to you saying about the withdrawal from heroin or the, you know, the detox, whatever it may be. Cold Turkey came out in October.
That's right, yeah.
So it's about that sort of time, isn't it? And wasn't the MBE actually handed back as a protest to Cold Turkey slipping down the charts? Or something, yeah. He said that jokingly, I know, but...
He stuck that in, yeah, that's a good one, Ah, right, so that dates the MBE to much later, yeah, September or something
I'm not sure, yeah, I don't know how this all works out chronologically, but Cold Turkey was released in the October, recorded late September. Right. Which was the single after Give Peace a Chance, and the one before Instant Karma, which would have been next year.
Yes.
I'm wondering if that's actually as a reaction or, you know, after the hospital admission. We'll have to see.
We don't quite know, because they went on to methadone at some point, and Yoko said getting off methadone is the hardest thing you could ever do, much harder than heroin. So, yeah, there's a case for saying that he was introducing Cold Turkey at the Toronto concert.
Yeah.
And he may well have been high. Like, we don't know.
Well, he read the lyrics off a clipboard.
Yeah.
Because it was that new a song. He didn't remember all the lyrics, so he had it on a clipboard.
I suppose it's conceivable that he could have been looking back 3 months to going Cold Turkey then.
Yeah, exactly.
Whether he relapsed, we don't know.
The lineup on that single, mate, you've got Ringo on drums, Klaus Voormann on bass, and Clapton on guitar.
That's great.
Yeah.
Again, I think those two singles, I'm not surprised they included them in the Plastic Ono Band, the extras, you know, the box set.
Yeah.
Because those two, I mean, just totally hold up. I would say they sound modern. People often say, oh, that could have been recorded yesterday. I don't think that's true, but
no,
it sounds fresh. I think that's the word.
Yeah, absolutely.
Very raw. All right. Brief comments on Abbey Road and maybe John Lennon's contribution. Where does it stand in the pantheon of Beatles records?
Oh, I love Abbey Road. I've said this to you before. I've got two eras of Beatles, as most people do. Some people sort of lump the first four or five together up to sort of Rubber Soul, Revolver. And then there's the second era from 66 onwards, say. Or some people sort of split it at Rubber Soul. And, you know, it depends. You know, you've got the Mop Top era, you've got the experimental era, you know, the two distinct sides to the Beatles. Abbey Road, it's one I turn to quite often. I listen to it more than Pepper. I certainly listen to it more than Let It Be. In fact, it probably is the one I listen to the most.
Beatles albums tick various boxes, don't they? So if you want to... If you want to go a bit dark or something, you can go to the White Album. If you want sort of a psychedelia and whimsy, you go to Pepper.
Yeah.
If you want something that just sounds amazingly well produced and, you know, you'd have to say maybe their best playing of their career, which stands to reason because it was the last thing. So they'd spent all that time developing. And I wonder whether the month was weirdly known for years as an unproductive month. But of course, if you look at it, it's incredibly productive January. And I wonder if all that time together, plus in India, they kind of honed their craft, because the guitars as well. I mean, Paul was just getting better and better as a bass player. The drumming is stellar, but also the guitar playing, I think, has gone up a notch.
Also, McCartney said to George Martin at the time, I want it to be like an old-fashioned recording where you're in charge. He wanted that discipline brought back to the group that George Martin always brought in those earlier sessions. And I think that's what it is. I think that's why, as you said, their playing is their best here, because George Martin is overseeing it with a rod of iron like he used to.
Yeah, and I feel like whether or not they discussed it, I think they all decided for pride purposes, let's just do a really good album.
Yeah.
A sort of indisputably good album. Because I think Let It Be is actually, particularly here in the latest mixes, I think if you actually go song by song, Let It Be is almost all classics, really.
Yeah, absolutely.
Or at least half of it. Abbey Road, I think, the one that you can't really dispute that it sounds fantastic.
It's the one that's got something on it, and it starts off with Come Together. If you're not hooked within those first two tracks, you're not going to like the rest of the album, you know, because he's got Octopus's Garden and Maxwell Silver Hammer on it, for God's sake, you know. But again, they don't seem like they shouldn't be there. It all flows perfectly with a bit of whimsy, as you call it. But at the same time, when you've got I Want You, She's So Heavy, and the medley, of course, the famous medley at the end. But for me, the standout is the two Harrison tracks, is Here Comes the Sun and Something.
There's a channel actually on YouTube that does reproductions of the songs using as close to the original instrumentation as they can. And they do these amazing versions. I'll put it on the show notes. They do Here Comes the Sun, yeah. And the complexity of that, of the time signatures and everything, they just pull it off very easily.
Yeah.
In terms of John Lennon's contributions, a lot of it, apart from Come Together, is either experimental, so I Want You, She's So Heavy, of course. And then these fragments, Sun King, Me, Mr. Mustard, Polythene Pam. Sun King, as we said last time, is basically them doing Albatross by Fleetwood Mac.
Yes.
And these wonderfully lush guitar sounds. In fact, that's John Lennon. When you hear Sun King, when you hear that, that kind of very tremolo-y phased guitar, that's actually John doing that.
I've noticed a couple of the songs also linked together. Well, I mean, some of the characters.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was just luck, you know. I mean, the bit my contribution to is Polythene Pam and Sun King and me and Mr. Mustard, so we just juggled them about till it made vague sense. And in Polythene Pam, me and Mr. Mustard, I said his sister Pam, and originally he said his sister Shirley in the lyrics, so I changed it to Pam and make it sound like he had something to do with it.
Well, the next track in the medley is the Sun King song.
That's where we pretend to be Fleetwood Mac for a few minutes.
And then you get into a sort of a language thing, which I couldn't figure out if it was some type of...
It's cod, you know. See, we did the introductions, and we call it the Sun Riff, you know, the little instrumental bit that's like Fleetwood Mac before we start singing. And we did it again on the end, so when we came to sing it, to make them different, you know, so it wasn't just the same riff, we just started joking, you know, singing Cuando para mucho. So we just made up, Paul knew a few Spanish words from school, you know, so we just strung any Spanish words that sounded vaguely like something. And of course we got chica ferdy, and that's a Liverpool expression, just like sort of, it doesn't mean anything, but you know, it's chica ferdy. The one we missed, we should have had paranoia, you know, but we forgot all about it. We used to call ourselves Los Paranoias.
And so then what, you know, was the sort of any idea behind Sun King? Is that any sort of symbolism, or is it just...
No, it was just a half a song I had, which I never finished, which was one way of getting rid of it without ever finishing it, you know. And it's sort of, you know, the sort of medley went, and then we sort of wanted a change of atmosphere, so then here comes the Sun King, you know, why not? And here he comes, and everybody's happy, and... Condo para mucho, etc., etc.
Paranoias. Okay.
Yeah, we might get hit with that in those countries, you know, if they take it off separate. Cake and eat it is another nice line, too. Because they have that in Spanish, queja or something, which is queja and eat it.
Me and Mr. Mustard, was it a song that you had from way back? Or?
I wrote it in India, so that was pre the Beatles' double album, so it's that old. And it was from some newspaper clipping that the title was Mean Mr. Mustard, about some guy done something or other. But of course the story's nothing like him, you know, just that was, it was like the newspaper title heading.
Yeah, because in fact it's quite short as well.
Yeah, well that's another half a song which I never finished, you know, so I put it in there.
From Mean Mr. Mustard straight to Polythene Pam, who turned out to be Mean Mr. Mustard's sister, and this is sort of getting back into your actual rock and roll again, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a bit like Not Fade Away and some, you know, Summertime Blues and everything. That's another half a song I wrote in India, you know, about a kinky girl in a polythene bag, you know.
Pre-bagism days,
oh,
too,
yeah,
isn't it?
Yes, yes. Polythene bags.
See-through polythene bag.
Yeah, right. That's what she wears, you know. She didn't drag in a polythene bag.
So it comes out in September, but just before that, obviously, when they finish recording it, there's a couple of very, very important dates in August. August the 20th is the last time they're ever in Abbey Road Studios together.
Right, okay.
So that becomes, you know, a huge deal, really, in Beatles history. And I think it's in Ken McNabb's book. I think they were there till about 1 in the morning. I don't know if that was the morning of the 22nd, of the 21st, sorry. But they sort of innocuously all leave this session at 2 in the morning from Abbey Road, and that's the last time they'd ever be in the studio together. And then 2 days later, we get essentially like the last time the Beatles were ever together, breathing the same air, so to speak.
Yeah.
The photo session at Tittenhurst, where, again, they just look visually stunning.
It's just amazing to see that progression from Mop Top to Pepper to 69, you know. Just, it's four different people. They look like four completely different people, four adults, you know. And as I said last time, it just fascinates me that there's just this seven-year window or whatever it is. That's all it was.
I know, it's absolutely mad.
Yeah.
There's a documentary that was made sometime this year called The World of John and Yoko, and it's just as wacky as you'd imagine.
Of course.
But there is a really cool clip of him, I think we mentioned this last time, actually, of him watching the Some Other Guy clip from 62. So you got the 69 John Lennon watching the 62 John Lennon. And you can only wonder what he was thinking. He was thinking, God, who's that guy? You know, that was 40 years ago or something. I'd love to know what he was thinking when he was watching that.
Absolutely.
And that's it, you know, in terms of them being together in the same space. And through the 70s, we got lots and lots of occasions where there was only three of them. You know, there's a papers signing in September where one of them happens to be away. I think George's mother was ill and she died, actually.
Right.
And then Ringo misses one. This famous thing that Mark Lewisohn was talking about a couple of years ago, this where they discuss the next album, a Christmas album. Ringo's not there. So by hook or by crook, you know, you never see them ever together. They're never in the same room together after August 69. So it's just seven, like I said, 7 years.
Yeah, it's all the solo stuff kicks off from here. I think Harrison he records some demos of All Things Must Pass, I think, in this particular time. Ringo starts a solo album round about now. And then obviously, as you say, with things like Toronto going on, and Linda McCartney gives birth to Mary, I think, later in this year. So he doesn't go to Isle of Wight to see Dylan, but the other three do. You know, it's fragmenting. It already has been fragmenting. You know, they sell their last remaining shares in NEMS this year. You know, it's the gradual sort of like disassembly of the group, you know, financially, legally, and personally, all happening.
Of course, if it was around now, we'd all know, wouldn't we? It would be clear what was going on, but no one really had too much of an idea.
George would be tweeting from Abbey Road, mate. Yeah. Bloody John's...
There's a bed in the studio.
Bloody John's had another go at me. You know?
One funny thing that happens, the end of August, John, George and Ringo see Dylan at the Isle of Wight.
That's it, yeah.
Another great picture of them just looking like they're at Glastonbury or something, just like hairy students at Glastonbury. But the funny part is, have you seen the pictures of Dylan and George Harrison playing tennis?
Don't think I have, mate. No.
Again, look online. They're in really good quality. They're not wearing tennis gear. I think one of them's wearing a denim shirt or something. But what happened was John and George went to a house that Dylan was renting. And John famously wanted Dylan to play on a demo of Cold Turkey. So again, we've got Cold Turkey. So this is end of August.
Yeah.
So we can date the writing of it to then. And there's a piano, no, it's a guitar demo that John did, and he wanted Dylan to be on a piano demo, and Dylan wasn't interested or something. It's probably one of those things that is completely innocuous, but has been blown up out of all proportion.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
But the tennis match is very funny. Like, I'm trying to imagine, you don't see John Lennon, I think, but imagine him in the umpire's chair. You know, advantage Dylan.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he'd have been the only one wearing white, that's for sure.
Yeah, calling foot faults on George Harrison, things like that. And then in September, we get the recording of Cold Turkey that we mentioned. John gets called for this 50s revival concert, which he was originally just supposed to be some sort of, not compare, but just come on, basically, and maybe introduce Chuck Berry or something. He says, oh, no, I want to play. So they famously have this rehearsal when he tells Alan Klein on the plane that he's leaving. Yeah. And Alan Klein says, I'll keep it to yourself. That Sweet Toronto concert, the audio has been very much cleaned up and now sounds quite, well, really good, in fact.
Yeah, as I say, I only ever saw the VHS version of it many years ago.
Yeah, me too, yeah.
I was thinking that as John Lennon hasn't played for years, hasn't been on stage for years, and then suddenly he goes with no rehearsal with a band that never played together before. And that's a concert. That was scary. And I thought, well, he must know what he's doing.
Okay, we're just going to do numbers that we know, you know, because we've never played together before.
So no sound check, no rehearsal, no nothing. And that's the way it sounds, too. And so we just started playing, and it was very weird at first. I couldn't hear Eric, I couldn't hear John. The monitor system, it was really very, very hard. So, you know, people now see those Toronto concerts, they have to really think of what a tough job that was. You know, it was really hard.
Thank you.
The audience loved it. It was great. Most of the people on a concert, they still know of the old Beatles. They would have loved to hear all the old Beatle tracks, and he didn't do that. So they loved to see John anyways. I think they were very polite, too. In particular, when Yoko came and was singing, then it was very, very hard. You know, if it wasn't John, I think they would have thrown tomatoes on stage. And it's funny because me standing behind Yoko, I got a completely different feeling, because for me, it was an amazing thing she was doing. She was screaming, and I really felt she was trying everything to express this hurt and this wish to have peace on earth. And I think that's, you have to say, one up for Yoko, you know.
Then we'd finished with Yoko's number, because you can't go anywhere after you've reached that sort of pitch.
Yeah.
And to end the show, I just said, look, at the end, when she's finished doing whatever she's doing, just lean your guitars on the amps and let it keep howling, and we can get off like that. Because you can't very well go jijing like the Beatles and bow at the end of screaming and 50 watts of feedback.
Thank you.
you're a John Lennon fan, you haven't seen that, you've got to get on it, because it's visually quite amazing. To add to the trauma of their lives with the heroin and everything, Yoko miscarries again this year.
Yep.
Second time. John Lennon is selected as Man of the Decade.
Yes.
Now, in Lewison's book, Tune In, and this was something I knew about, actually, at the beginning of 1960, something like May 1960, a newspaper, must have been The Echo, did a feature on beatniks, and they actually took some photos inside John and Stu's Gambia Terrace flat, you know, that student-y flat they had, where they were burning the furniture and stuff to keep warm. And apparently John's in it, but I'm not sure. But Alan Williams is there, you can see him. But it's so funny, that's the beginning of the 60s. To go from there to John Lennon being Man of the Decade, you think of this sort of Hamburg punk dropout who's sort of heading for the streets, really.
But who decided that? Was that, it was a TV thing, wasn't it? It wasn't like a internationally recognised award as such, was it?
The Man of the Decade. Yeah. Three people were chosen by three people. I think Desmond Morris chose John, didn't he?
That's right. I knew Desmond Morris was there somewhere, yeah.
They're pretty bizarre. And then the other two were John F. Kennedy and Ho Chi Minh, I think, was the other one. And then you have this, this interview of him strolling the grounds going, oh, the 60s was just waking up in the morning and everything's going to be great. And very optimistic.
Full of optimism because of the contacts I've made personally throughout the world, including yourself, you know, whether it was on seeing you on TV or whatever, knowing that there's other people around who I can get on, you know, agree with, you know, and I'm not insane, I'm not alone, you know, I've met, that's just on a personal level. And of course the Woodstock, Isle of Wight, all the mass meetings of the youth is completely positive for me. And the fact that now we're all getting to know, we're always showing our flags, you know, and when you show your flag, you're not alone, you know, it's like we no need to be the a few Christian martyrs, because there's lots of us, and don't be afraid, because they do look after you, whoever's up there, you know, if you get on with it. And I'm completely positive, and when I'm negative, I've got Yoko, who is just as strong as me, and it helps, you know. And just, this is only the beginning. This 60s bit was just a sniff. The 60s was just waking up in the morning, you know, and we haven't even got to dinner time yet, and I can't wait, you know, I just can't wait. I'm so glad to be around. And it's just going to be great, and there's going to be more and more of us. And whatever you're thinking there, Mrs. Grundy of South Birmingham on toast, you know, you don't stand a chance. A, you're not going to be there when we're running it. And B, you're going to like it when you get less frightened of it, you know. And it's going to be wonderful, and I believe it. And, of course, we all get depressed and down about it. But when I'm down, or when John and Yoko's down, Desmond will be up, or somebody else will be up. There's always somebody carrying the flag and beating the drum, you know. So they, whoever they are, don't stand a chance, because they can't beat love, because all those old bits from religion and that about love being all-powerful is true, you know. And that's the bit they can't do, you know, they can't handle it.
And then we're actually in December. We've got to now start rolling this out a bit more. Let's go back to the films.
December is interesting from a personal point of view, because Christmas Eve 69 he went to Rochester Cathedral, which is literally a mile down the road from where I am now, and I lived in Rochester for 20 years, and I think it's the only time he ever appeared in my adopted hometown, apart from, I think, the Beatles might have played in the Odeon in 1962 or something.
Did they perform there?
No, what it was, they flew back from Canada, where they'd been launching their global peace campaign. But then what they did on their arrival back in the UK, they were driven to Rochester Cathedral. They were going to join a fast and a sit-in that was calling for peace and highlighting world poverty. And they arrived in the white Rolls Royce at Rochester Cathedral, you know. And it's supposed to be a 24-hour sleepover with the homeless. The crowds apparently got wind of it, and he cut it short, because they were going to stay overnight in the cathedral. But a small crowd was already present. It felt likely that their continued presence would have caused a commotion. This is what it's saying here. They briefly posed for press photographers. They were with a comedian called Dick Gregory, who I don't know.
Oh, yeah. American.
And they briefly went inside the cathedral. They soon returned to the limousine to avoid being mobbed. They later attended midnight mass in the cathedral before returning to Tittenhurst. There we go. But, yeah, from a personal point of view, you know, that's just a local thing to me. It's one of the last things that's actually documented for the year, which was Christmas Eve 1969.
Yeah, the thing they've got to worry about all the time is being spotted and being mobbed and everything. Yeah. So just before that, as you mentioned, they well, there's a couple of things. They did a Peace for Christmas gig at the Lyceum. This is the one that's got Delaney and Bonnie, Clapton, Preston. There's about 30 people, Keith Moon. Some good photos. And they did a very, very long version of Cold Turkey, which I imagine if you were there and in the right mood, or in the right state even, probably would have been pretty amazing, like a happening. And they did one of Yoko's, maybe Don't Worry, Kyoko. Because yeah. It's actually got this rock riff, which goes back to the Everlys, like ding 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 ding. You know, they're very, very well known.
It's the B-side of Cold Turkey, isn't it?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah,
yeah.
But it's something the rock guys can do.
Yeah,
because it's just that the whole way through it. So they're happy with that, and then Yoko just howls and screams.
Yeah,
very. That was John Lennon's last concert in England, and then we get. I mean, there's so many other things we haven't even mentioned, but anyway, he did a performance in Cambridge earlier in the year, which was just feedback.
Right.
Some sort of hall they were in. But the War Is Over billboards are born at this time. So yeah. You get the famous refrain, War Is Over If You Want It, which will end up in a song 2 years later.
Mm-hmm.
But it's about 20 cities.
Mr. Lennon, should we see this new action for Peace as a follow-up of the Bed In?
It's a part of our advertising campaign for Peace, following the Bed in Amsterdam and Montreal, and the MBE, and everything else we're doing.
Did you get encouraging reactions after the Bed In and after the returning of MBE?
Yes, the Bed In and all the things we do take time to have effect, you know. I mean, the initial effect is like throwing a stone in the water. But we're still getting reactions to the Amsterdam Bed In now. That's the ripples that take time to reach the shore, you know.
And do you really believe that such actions could be a contribution to world peace?
Well, I mean, it's like asking Mr. Coca-Cola, do you really believe your advertisements are contributing towards selling Coca-Cola? You know, ask him. It certainly does contribute. We believe in advertising, you know. And on David Frost's program the other night, we saw some... this firm that is starting to make adverts against racialism. You know, the adverts weren't too good, but the idea, it was, we thought we'd invented the idea, of course, but somebody else has thought of it. And it's a very good idea to advertise for peace or against racialism or whatever it is. You must advertise, you know. That's what everybody else does.
I see those posters in Spanish, in French, in German. In which places are you campaigning now?
Of course, in Amsterdam, Tokyo, New York, LA, Montreal, Toronto, Berlin, Rome, Paris, Athens, London. I think that's it. 11 places altogether.
Why not in Cairo and Tel Aviv? Well, why not in Saigon and in Hanoi?
We had enough trouble getting them up in London, you know, and in the places where we knew we had contacts. We don't have any contacts in Saigon, Hanoi, etc.
But who are doing it for you in those 11 places?
Some places it's friends of ours, and other places it's people we've hired, you know.
How many posters have been distributed in each place?
It's approximately 2,000 small posters this size. Poster, that's not counting big billboards, and wherever we could we got large billboards, you know.
Last question, Mr. Lennon, how about the cost of such a campaign?
I don't want to think about the cost of such a campaign, you know, but I'll have to write a song or two to earn the money
back.
Best
wishes from the Dutch TV and the Dutch audience for you and Mrs. Lennon, of course.
Thank you. Peace.
The idea of something could happen if you want it, I
war,
think that's
war is over, if you
great.
Want. Yeah.
You know, I mean, we could argue for hours about how much power we have. You know, we've got the power of the dollar, we've got the power to vote. But I think it's just introducing even just that idea that, yeah, the better world is there and that we can play a part in it. It's this hippie inclusive thing.
It's up to us, but you're the ones that want it, like you say. Yeah, you have to want this to make it happen.
Yeah, you have to want it. That's it. Yep. Yeah, they go to Canada, as we said. They meet Marshall McLuhan. All this stuff's on YouTube as well, these interviews. He comes across well, I must say.
Yeah.
And then Trudeau as well. He meets with the then president or prime minister. Prime minister. Because his son is now in power, isn't he? Justin Trudeau.
He is indeed. That's right, yeah.
Yeah, so is it fair to say that the peace thing almost was a 69 thing? they sort of morphed into New Left anti-war, which is not quite the same. Anti-war, as in anti-Vietnam, is not quite the same as just a generic peace idea.
Yeah, I mean, that was the general idea of Woodstock as well this year.
Mm.
The hippies had been born a year or two earlier, you know, they were in existence, but I think this was the year that cemented, you know, it just brought them to the attention of the world because of these big events and people embracing that culture, like Lennon, who was on the front pages every day. And it literally died, like we said, with Altamont. It literally died in December. How many hippies do you know carried on through the 70s? Bang, the 60s, as you said, there was a cut-off. Boom, it happened.
Yeah, I mean, there's even a news report, I remember, from Haight-Ashbury.
Yeah.
Pretty soon after 67.
Yep.
And it's become a cliche even then, almost.
Yeah, back to normal.
And I'm not saying for a second that hippie ideals are cliches. Well, some of them maybe are, but they've been made into that, you know.
Yeah.
They become Neil from The Young Ones, you know. But I think a lot of the ideals still hold, and I mean, people are still talking about them now.
Oh, they do, but as I say, it wasn't prominent as much as it was in 69.
It's funny how with John Lennon, what I've realised is that almost every year of his life has a different flavour.
Mm-hmm.
And the flavour of 1970 was all turning inward. It was all Primal Scream.
Yes.
It was all dealing with his own personal pain. Whereas 69 had been very public, so it's very, what a strange life.
When did his father come back on the scene?
Originally in 64, a long time before. Then he sort of, John Lennon sort of half disowned him and half invited him to live with him. It was very complicated. But the last time they ever actually met was 1970. Soon after the Primal Therapy, that's when he went ballistic at him.
That's why I thought there was a connection to 1970 and his father. That was it. Yeah, okay.
Yeah. So he seemed like he got very sidetracked the next year and all this peace stuff. The thing is, it's still out there, isn't it? I mean, nowadays, you know.
Oh, yeah. No, as I say, but I just think that it peaked in the public consciousness in 69 because of baggism, because of Woodstock, because of the Stones in Hyde Park. You know, this whole year, a great year for sort of technological advances and, you know, news events, as we mentioned in the previous episode, but it was the year of peace and love. People say 67 was the summer of love, but I think 69 probably as a whole for a 12-month period really sort of encapsulated it.
Also, it's now morphing with anti-Vietnam.
Of course, so, you've got all the protests happening as well, yeah.
Because like I said, you've got the peace movement, which in some ways was a more... I'm not even using generic as a bad thing, but just a general, let's just say a general idea. You know, we are much more together than we think. You know, let's be inclusive. But not in a sort of... It's not done... They put flowers in guns, famously.
Yeah.
Which is obviously an anti-war statement anyway. But suddenly you get militancy. And I'm not sure this is for a couple of years later, although we've already covered that year, 72, for example.
Yeah.
I'm not sure John Lennon, very interesting how it morphs with his own identity crisis that he had anyway. It's like, who is John Lennon? Is he a hippie? Is he very aggressive? Is he anti-Vietnam or is he just generally in favour of peace? Is he all of those things? He probably is, isn't he?
Exactly. Yeah.
This keeps my enthusiasm for Glass Onion, basically. The more you look at this guy's life, it's just crazy.
Yeah, as I say, it's been so much written about him. And it's just fascinating that when you consider what his childhood was like and his upbringing, for him to become man of the decade
yes,
in 1969, like I say, when he's up in contention against John F. Kennedy, for God's sake.
Yeah.
It's a fascinating story, and I can fully see why you find him fascinating and why your interest lies specifically with John Lennon rather than the Beatles as a whole.
Yeah, well, Ken McNabb said something, like I say, when he was on, he said, just even his name, it has an aura about it.
Yeah.
But I'm fully aware that part of this is that I fell for him and his voice and everything about him when I was a teenager. So it's probably just there forever, no matter what he does or I find out about him. Let's hope we don't find out anything too terrible in the future.
I think we would have found out by now, to be honest. Probably. Unless Yoko has got something on her deathbed to reveal. That's it. We've opened every closet, I think, and all the skeletons have fallen out, mate, to be honest.
Yeah, she'll probably reveal that John was the light of the world. So that's just basically what she says anyway.
Yeah.
But no, the kind of happy ending that I always like to bring to these things. It's just that everything John Lennon did in 1969, because most of it was filmed,
Yeah. Or
is in audio form. It's all there, you know, and the photos are being, I'm sure the Get Back book, which I haven't bought, but I'm sure there's some breathtaking photos in there, yeah, in breathtaking quality.
If it's as good as the anthology book, I'm definitely picking it up.
Yeah, but I think just his voice, as in his speaking voice and his singing voice and the way he looked, I think he just left an indelible impression.
Yep, and he upset a lot of bloody people, a lot of the establishment, mate, you know, because of it. You know, I think the members of the establishment, like we was talking about lords and all this lot, would look at this guy with the long hair and the beard and they try and dismiss him. But underneath all of that was a highly intelligent and passionate man who cared about a lot of things. And he, as I said, he could stand his corner.
Yeah, and it seems like he could both play the game and be truthful.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's where him and Paul are maybe quite similar. Despite having personality differences, they both lived this thing. You know, they're the only two people who knew what it was like to be the real chief Beatles. Nothing against George, you know, obviously great work, but to have that pressure to be Lennon and McCartney, for God's sake.
Yeah.
I want to carry this on now. I don't want to stop. Let's freewheel for a bit. What do you think will happen in the future in terms of releases? Because there's not really much John left.
No, it's amazing that we've got the technology to go back and get all of this Get Back footage and bring out a wonderful, brand new. It's going to be brand new for us, mate, you know, because it's not going to be that 90-minute version that we know and some of us love and some of us hate. I'm so looking forward to that because what could they then do? Could they go back and clean something else up or find some old footage somewhere? You know, I always hope and pray that somewhere in a dusty cupboard somewhere is all those Top of the Pops performances that got wiped, or the Ready Steady Go stuff that we can't find. There's still a lot of that about, but there's still a few bits of that missing. You know, we live in hope that there's stuff out there, mate, that can be found again and cleaned up. And after our conversation last week, I went back and started Anthology again. I tend to watch it every couple of years. You know, I watch one a week over sort of 2 months in the run-up to Christmas, because that was when it was first shown, wasn't it, in the run-up to Christmas originally. And even then, it just fascinates me. I go back and watch the complete Beatles, and to see Alan Williams being interviewed, you know, long gone now, you know, or Jerry Marsden on that. You know, there must be stuff out there that can be found and brought to the world again. I don't get as obsessive as you do. I mean, I love the extra bits on Anthology, the three CDs, but that was enough for me. I will not go into every single version of every single song because, you know, they're basically the same.
Yeah, well, I got to the point a few years ago, I think, with that, where I'm like, I'd rather just hear something that's a new, slightly different, like an outtake even, just hear the same songs. But it's just certain ones, yeah, they do a good job of cleaning them up. And I think he's, like I was saying earlier, I think his voice, if we just center on John Lennon for a sec, his voice is the one that, it has that eloquence. And I mean, I was in India last 2 years ago, and I did three overnight trips on trains, and so almost purposely, really, well, I didn't go for any luxury at all.
Yeah.
And they're quite rough journeys, and I had the Lennon Legend.
Oh, right.
And it was just his voice in the middle of the night, listening on headphones on a train in India, trying to get to sleep.
Yeah.
Just the eloquence. And that speaking voice, as I said, it's not just the singing voice, is it?
No, it's when you hear him reading from some of his books or even interviews. He must have been a fascinating... Dick Cavett's probably personal favourite after Janis Joplin. And it's just fascinating, like the David Frost one. Because he was so eloquent, he was so intelligent. And, you know, as I say, a lot of people, some of the interviewers may have tried to have dismissed him. Al Capp, for God's sake, took him on and lost.
Yeah.
And it's that side of him. You know, how can a rock and roller have an opinion? How can a rock and roller be so passionate about something or be political? And they can, you know. Yeah, absolutely fascinating character. And as you said, so many different layers to him. And there'll always be stuff we'll be discovering, mate.
Okay, wonderful. Well, I hope everyone enjoyed that. A little trawl through 1969. Just another year in the 60s.
Yes.
Yeah, just mind-blowing events. All right, can you just go through your podcast again?
Very quickly, yeah. There's The Stinking Paws, which is our movie review podcast. I think you've been guests on all of these, actually. We've got Real Britannia, which I do, which is focusing on British movies, old and new. And Rainbow Valley, which is probably the reason I was brought on for this one, mate, which is a documentary that I do of the 60s. When I do years, I tend to do hits and headlines, a bit like the old Rock and Roll Years TV programme. But, you know, there's two-hour specials on Matt Munro, Dusty Springfield, Janis Joplin, and then I've covered the JFK assassination. I've done a two-part special on Brian Epstein. I've done one on the making of Sergeant Pepper for the Beatles fans out there. Currently working on the making of Zulu, which is my next one. Sort of on the back burner, I've got one coming up on Joe Meek, which is really fascinating.
You mention Altamont already?
I've done Altamont. Yeah, I didn't mention it, but yeah, there was a two and a bit hour Altamont, which is I think
we mentioned that in part one.
It's all there, mate. You know, it's I'd like to do more, but they're very time consuming.
Yeah.
And also, I'm one of the hosts of the Talking Pictures TV podcast as well.
Lovely. It's hard to know what to say, really, because I don't know when this is going out. It's probably December, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So, Merry Christmas, everyone.
we'd have watched the Get Back documentary by now. Yeah.
We've just been talking about
and
it.
Hated it.
Already seen it.
Yeah, we couldn't stand it. It was horrible.
I'm sure people have been enjoying it. I'm sure.
I can't see people not enjoying it. Well, to Beatles fans, it is like manna from heaven, mate, isn't it? You know.
But it's funny, I think we said this earlier, with the public, it's not quite the same. I don't think there's a bit of buzz, probably, but... Us being in the Beatles community, we probably don't realise how apathetic the public are to something.
Exactly. Nobody knows. Nobody cares, mate.
But we do.
Exactly.
Okay, well, listen, thanks very much for being on again.
Absolute pleasure. Looking forward to coming back soon. And obviously, you're going to be joining me on a couple of mine soon as well. So.
Yeah, probably the one that will have come out is Dead of Night. Well, it has to because it's Halloween.
It's the Halloween episode, yep.
That was an enjoyable review. We're doing Fish Called Wanda next at some point.
Excellent. That'll be in the new year, yep.
All right. Stay on the line, mate, and talk to you soon.
Okie doke. Cheers, mate. Thank you.
Cheers.
So there you have it. I hope you enjoyed that, friends, both the conversation and the multiple clips I added to it. It was a lot of work to get those in, but, you know, a labour of love. And also funny there to hear a laughably early Merry Christmas from mid-October, which now is laughably late in late February. But hey, that's the podcasting world. Scott, by the way, I know he's going to be listening to this, has still not watched Get Back. Can you believe it? How naughty. Really makes me want to say, he's not the Messiah. He's a very naughty boy. So, Scott, come on, mate, watch Get Back and give us your feedback. He'll be on, I'm sure, at some point, so we'll get to that then. The next show is a return to the John Lennon-Bob Dylan relationship. That's all I'm going to say. In fact, I'm going to leave this as a teaser. I'm recording it this week with one returning guest and one new guest. But anyone who liked the shows we did, episodes 43 and 44, then we're going to be going much deeper. And that's another talking about fascinating dynamics and relationships. John Lennon and Bob Dylan is an endlessly fascinating one. So that's it. I will see you next month for the next episode of Glass Onion on John Lennon. It's just a little something tribute to the book The Beatles and the Avant-Garde After the Music. So keep listening. I'll see you very soon. Thanks for listening. Take care of yourselves in this crazy world. Take care of your families. And all the best. Goodbye. If you'd like to support my work across my three podcasts, which are Glass Onion on John Lennon, Life and Life Only, and Film Gold, go to buymeacoffee.com/AntonyRotunno, where you can make a one-off donation or take out a monthly or yearly subscription, which will give you early access, bonus podcast content, and extracts from the upcoming book based on the Glass Onion podcast. Thanks again for listening. Next,